How you doing, guys? My name is Sean Spitzer. I'm one of the trainers here at Unreal Training Center out here in L.A. So I got about 20 years experience working in real time. I've worked with multiple engines, and I have to say that this one is the best. At least, I think so. And let me show you why. So we're going to be talking about the fundamentals of ray tracing in Unreal. So let's take a look at this up close. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run you through how to set it up, how to get everything working in the way that you need it to get it started. And then I'm going to show you some of the ins and outs of how to control your lighting and your shadows and how to work with some of the control that you have with specularity and so forth. Pretty much what we're going for when we made this ray tracing tool, we really want to have it so that you can have little to no hesitation working in it, so it's smooth transition, and you actually get the visual fidelity that you would on regular ray tracing. Now, let's go ahead and look at how to set that up in Unreal. So first up, what you need to do is we go to Edit, Project Settings. In Project Settings, you want to go in here and you want to search for Ray Trace. Now, you can either scroll down and go to your rendering, under your engine, right here, or you can just type it in. This is awesome that if you know, if you can type right, my typing was all over the place there. And you can look up Ray Trace and make sure it's turned on. So another step you need to do also, and when you turn that on, Unreal's going to prompt you and say, hey, man, you need to restart. So what you can do is just wait on that just to make sure everything else is in the right spot. But just keep in mind, you will have to restart for it to actually work. So once we've done that, we also want to go to Windows, which is underneath Platform. Go to Windows here, and you want to turn on, under Default RHI, you want to turn on DirectX 12. You got to make sure that's turned on. And a few other things that I like to do, when I work with ray trace, sometimes I'll have some bakelites way in the background, and my primary hero objects are going to be ray trace, because I want it to look good, there's no hesitation, I'm focusing on those guys, and there's a few other things you can do to really get yourself to have a really nice output. It also helps a little bit with ray trace here too. One of them is called G-Buffer. And with our G-Buffer, you want to set your engine rendering to high precision normals. This is going to complement both types. Another one you want to do is for your reflections, you want to set your reflections to 1024 right there. Really helpful to be able to do that. And that's going to give you some better output. And again, that's catering a little bit more towards the baked type stuff. So let's go ahead and close this out for a second. And this right here, ladies and gentlemen, is a ray traced environment. So this is pretty much what you get in game. You'd think I'm in game engine right now, but I am not. I am in the editor, so I'm not actually hitting play is what I mean to say. I'm not in play mode, I'm in editing mode. And this, we're getting a nice reflection here, and you'll see that our reflection isn't limited by the visibility of where my camera's positioned, such as a screen space, or even the circular reflection, which is based on a circular shape, or the box one. And each one of those have a limitation. But this particular one, I'm in here, and you can see in real time the reflection I'm getting. Really nice, really good output there. Let me hit the G key. So these notes, I'll keep them on screen so you can actually see them a little bit more. So we, again, we want to do all these things to set it up. The next thing we want to do is take a look, again, at our precision normals, and we talked about the reflections, but we also want to look at our control for our lights. That is super important to be able to control the softness of your shadows. So let's go and look at that real quick. And again, these are on the screen there, so if you want to take a picture or you're videotaping it anyway. So the one of the lights we're going to look at first is our spotlight here. So there are all these lights, when you first have them in the scene, the one thing you need to do is make sure that they're movable. All your lights need to be movable. And what that does is this is going to update in real time. Notice, normally when you work in Unreal, if you're familiar with it, when you work with Unreal and you move a light around, Unreal, if it's a stationary or static, will say, hey, you need to rebuild your lights. We don't have to do this here. This is on the fly. This is updating. By default, when you open up Unreal, you'll see that you'll actually will have options to be able to make sure that your light is casting ray trace. Now, all these will be on by default, except when it comes maybe to the skylight. So just double check your lights when you work with it. So in the skylight, you just go in the same area. And again, you make sure that it's casting ray trace shadows and so forth. So I'll bring that back, go back up here. I closed it on accident. Let's open that up again. And you scroll down and you'll see cast ray trace shadows right there. So this will give us the best accurate quality. I just want to make sure I pointed that out. So they do need to be movable. With that set into place, let's go and play with some of the shadows here for our spotlight. So in our spotlight, we're going to go in here and we're going to mess with our source radius. And as we mess with this, you'll notice our shadows get softer. See that right there? Really cool in real time there. Really nice. So one of the lights that Unreal really likes is the rec light, or, you know, looks like an area light, acts like an area light, but this is called the rec light here. And this guy is a really nice type of light that we've made that caters to ray trace. It gives us physical control of this light, and as we move it around, as we scale it up, it actually acts like an expanding light. It's pretty nice. And as you make it, close it down and make it smaller, you'll see your shadows get sharper. So you can soften it and close it here. And it's trying to simulate cinematic lighting as we play with this. You can see the barn doors. We can make those wider. Really nice. Then we also have height. Make it higher. So this guy's a really great light to use. And again, as I move it around, you see it's going to update in real time. So to mess with this guy, a good thing to keep in mind is your barn doors are really going to help you with the drop-off and the softness of some of the aspects of our rec light. Hopefully I don't lose my voice here. Let me get a shot of water. It's like, bah, bah, bah. There we go. Much better. All right, so the point light also has that same feature. So if we have a point light in here, and again, we can just drag one in if we need to, or we can just grab one that's existing floating around in our scene. Here we go, he's way in the bottom here. We can move this guy over. And he has the same type of control. When you play with him, again, you'll be messing. He's not super strong, but you can, again, mess with your source radius to soften up those shadows. Let me just put him back real quick. Just want to point that out. He has the same type of control that you would get over here with your spotlight. And again, the favorite light is this rec light. He is phenomenal. Does great work. Look at that. Just bump it up, move it down. Updating in real time at the G key. This is exactly what you're going to get in game. See reflection there. So let's play with the light a little bit. Some of the cool things that we can do with the lights. A cool feature that we can play with is right here under our source texture. I can load a texture that I've already created and drop it right into that source texture slot. And the cool thing about this, we can simulate what it looks like in real life. So as it projects, you're going to get like that whole office light kind of feel going on. Go and move it back a little bit. It's a little too close. And then we can play with some of his properties here, such as his barn door. And we can mess with the scale. Oh, mess with my attenuation on accident. There you go. You can get kind of the light that you're looking for. Pretty nice. So all this is real time. We're going and tweaking this guy out, and we're getting instant results. So some of the other things you could do, and let's go back to my slides. Let's look at the post-process volume, because this guy is really great. We've actually added some more features to that post-process to cater to our ray trace, and I'll show you some of the things that you can do to actually play with your sampling. And I got a little bit of a breakdown here and how to work with that. So let's go to my post-process volume. Got to be able to type post-process. There we go. That's important. So I'm going to open this guy up here. We're open up. We have ray trace options. Now I have my ambient occlusion ray trace. And let's open this so you guys can see a little bit better. Set to 2. We have our ray trace global illumination. Now mine's set to 1. It's doing a really good job. You're more than welcome to play with some of these. But remember, there's a limit on some of your bounces here. Just like regular global illumination, once light leaves the point of interest and bounces around, it loses energy. So it doesn't get quite as strong. So you get kind of the same kind of principles there. So just keep that in mind. We also have, again, ray trace reflections. Let me get another drink of water here. Sorry. And in the race trace reflections here, we also have a max bounce. I have just default 1 and 1, and then my roughness is 0.6. And these are actually working pretty well. Now, again, you'll see a little bit of pixelation because this is updating on the fly. This is kind of the nature of working with ray trace. But as we get more and more iterations, it's getting smoother and better and even sexier. So this one is 4.22.3. So we have 4.23 that just came out, and we have previews constantly connecting with that. So this guy's getting way just awesome. I'm loving every part of this guy right now. So now let's go on. Hopefully I don't lose my voice here. So you can see some of the bounces, some of the stuff you can play with, things to keep in mind. But there's also some really cool features when working with Ray Trace that we can use in the console command to get ourselves a little bit better visuals. So let's get a little bit closer to crunch here. Look at his chest plate here up close. Let me move back a little bit. Again, this is all ray trace. Look how nice that looks. Very beautiful, very nice. So if we want to make this look a little bit more crisper, we can go to the console command, and we can do tone mapper. In that tone mapper, I'm going to pull this up, and I'm going to type in sharpen. We're going to sharpen once. And you'll see it get a little bit crisper there with that. And you can even go higher, but you got to be careful. The higher you go with that, it can get really pixelated. So let's go ahead and turn that off. We'll go back to the tone mapper. We'll do sharpen 0, and we'll hit enter. So let me go and zoom out. And again, you can get higher with that number. Now, a lot of these, when you're working with the console command, you'll notice when I hit the console command, and I go in here and I start typing these up, say we just type in ray trace, there is a lot. There's a lot we can do. There's a lot of cool stuff. But who wants to type that all the time, right? Not so great, not so wonderful. So to be able to handle that, what we have is you can use the blueprint editor. So you can say event begin on play, and you can use the execute console command in there, and you can specify what you want it to do. So the numbers that you saw me punching in, 1 or 0, or maybe in this case, we have ray trace reflections with a max ray distance, we can punch in 500. And that right there will actually control automatically where we are, distance to things, and you can play with these, and you can actually get some really good automated stuff so you don't have to constantly go in the console and start typing them in all the time. So this is a pretty helpful tool to be able to do so. All right, let me go Alt-Tab back to this guy. So some things to also keep in mind. Again, when I use ray trace, like I emphasize what I said before, a lot of times my hero objects, I will keep them ray trace, the things that are objects of interest. Some stuff in the background, because Unreal does an amazing job with baking your lights, I'll have that stuff baked in the distance. You know, stuff that's like, you know, not so important, but it still does a wonderful job. And it's just a nice little marriage of working with these two together. And as I'm baking him, I'm going to make sure that all my lights, and I always do this by default before I make them movable. And again, you got to make sure your lights are movable. A lot of times I'll go in here by default, because if I'm doing that combo, I'll go in and make sure that my lights are casting area light shadows. And so if we scroll down just a little bit under light mass, you'll see use shadows for stationary lights. You'll turn this on just in case you decide to switch them to back and forth between a stationary and a ray trace. I just think it's a good idea to do that just in case, because you'll get confused. Why is Unreal telling me to rebake my lights? It's because you turned it from movable to something else. And this little prompt will help you keep on point for having good lights all the way across the board. And it doesn't really affect our ray trace, because you'll see it's grayed out right now. But it's just a good practice to have in mind. And you'll notice we have some decals working in here, really nice. And even my emissives are working great. If I hit the G key, you'll see some really nice glow off of these guys on these boxes. Really cool. I'm hit the F key to get a little bit closer. Look at that. Really nice global illumination. And I got a little bit of emissive coming off there. And it's giving me some little material lighting going on. Pretty cool. All right. So let me see here. Let me go back to my notes. So all these assets are brought to you by Jonathan Frederick. It's permanently free on the Asset Store. If you guys have any other questions, feel free to email me. I will be floating around the pods today. I'll be sitting there for a while, and then every once in a while you'll see me get up and maybe talk to some more people. So I'm available for your questions. putting myself out there to help you out. I've been teaching for many years and working in the industry, so you name it, I've probably tackled that particular situation or problem. We also have an online learning portal that you guys can check out. This will give you, like, you can start tracking your own learning path, and you can earn badges and so forth, and it's all ready to go there. So we also, like I mentioned earlier, if you guys heard me, we have an LA training center out here. So if you're interested, feel free to email me, and I'll make sure you get all the information you need. All right, there's a little doodad, I like to call it, on the screen. It's like futuristic type thingy. And you guys take a picture of that, put it on your phone. I'm the same person on my YouTube channel too. Exact same dumb jokes and everything. It's pretty cool. All right, cool, man. Awesome. Thank you guys for coming. And I hope that gave you a good view of how this all works.